Okay. Yeah, so good morning everyone, and welcome again to the Machine Learning Coffee seminar. So today we have Harri Lähdesmäki from Aalto University talking about deep and non-parametric methods for longitudinal data. And then as always, so you are welcome to ask the questions using the chat during the presentation, and then I will ask the questions, and then of course after the presentation we will then open the floor for all questions. But so please go ahead, Harri.
All right, thank you, and thanks for the introduction. So before I start telling you about our longitudinal modeling methods, I just wanted to briefly mention what our research group does in general. So the research is broadly divided between probabilistic machine learning, computational biology and biomedicine, and then applications in different molecular biology projects and biomedicine projects. And currently the group has something like 14 researchers, and there's the link to our group webpage. All right, so let's start with a brief introduction. So what is longitudinal data? So it's a special type of time series data which is obtained from multiple subjects or individuals, and each subject is measured repeatedly over time. And thereby the measurements may have correlations among the within the each subject, and also across the multiple subjects, something which is shared with all the subjects. And typically the data is such that it has a relatively high number of individuals in the study, and then a relatively low number of measurements per subject. And if you think about this kind of experimental design, so this is relatively common in various applications, especially in biomedicine, but also in psychology and sociology and all sorts of consumer behavior studies.
All right. Harri, yep. Can I ask you one question still?
Okay.
I assume that not all the measurements are done at the same time instance either.
That's true. In this drawing they are, but in general not.
Okay, thank you.
So what methods exist? So especially in the biomedical domain, the applications are really dominated by different types of generalized linear mixed models. And for the Gaussian likelihood case, the model can be written something like shown here. So the measurements are modeled using a linear fixed effect part, which is shared across all the subjects, and then something called random effect parts, which is sort of models the random effects across the groups or individuals, and then additive noise. And then the model is clearly very interpretable. It's linear model. It's very fast to solve. It's still relatively powerful, and it has very, very good software support. So those are maybe some of the reasons why it has become so popular. On the other hand, longitudinal modeling field has a very, very long history, and there are many different methods. Some of them are listed here: generalized additive models, splines, different types of Bayesian hierarchical models, Gaussian processes, Gaussian process ANOVA, and so on. But there are still some challenges. In general, how to model nonlinear, non-stationary, or heterogeneous effects, heterogeneous across the individuals. How to account for uncertainty in the explanatory variables, for example. How to determine the relevance of different covariates, X, in the model. And how to model high-dimensional data with possibly many missing values. So, what we have done in the past is somehow summarized here, some of our a bit earlier work, and then today I will focus on these two relatively recent papers. The first one being a so-called LGPR method that will appear in bioinformatics soon, and then a method called longitudinal variational autoencoder that will be appearing in the ASTATS later this year. So I will start with the LGPR method. the Juho Timonen is the first author, and then Henrik Mannerström and Aki Vehtari have also contributed to this work. So this method builds on so-called additive Gaussian processes. In this case, the output is one-dimensional, and I'll go through some of the technical details so that you get a kind of better understanding how this works. And let's start with the notation first. So the longitudinal data set X, Y contains n data points with d covariates. So the covariate matrix is n by d matrix, where each data item or the covariate vector xi can contain possibly both continuous and categorical variables. And then the response variables or the measurements are simply a vector of length n. They can be either continuous or discrete. Many of the longitudinal modeling methods which have been proposed in the literature, they assume that the underlying function that we are modeling can be decomposed as a sum of J terms, and such that each of these elements in the sum depend only a subset of the variables, typically just an individual covariate or maybe a pair of covariates. And in our work, we assume that each additive component in the sum has an independent Gaussian process prior with a component specific covariance function kj with some kernel parameters and then the marginal variance alpha j squared. And thereby the sum itself has an additive Gaussian process prior where the covariance function is now a sum of the covariance functions. So this is nothing new. It's something that has been proposed already in the previous century. So how then to apply this to longitudinal data? So much of the magic kind of is hidden in the kernel functions. So we follow kind of the kernel function definitions proposed in our previous work, but I'll go through them briefly. So for the stationary shared effects of continuous covariates, we use the standard exponentiated quadratic kernel. This is by far the most commonly used kernel in Gaussian process literature. Some of the shared effects of continuous variables may be non-stationary, and there are many possibilities how to model non-stationary effects. We use the monotonic nonlinear input warping approach proposed by Snoek, if I remember correctly, where the covariate is first mapped via a monotonic function W, and then after this input warping, we apply the standard exponentiated quadratic kernel. Again, a standard technique. And here's an illustration what the realizations from such a model could look like. So if you look at the left of the first column, that shows a realization from the exponentiated quadratic kernel, where the x-axis now corresponds to an age or time in this particular study. And maybe another example of the shared effect is shown in the fourth column, where the covariate is kind of hypothetically a blood pressure, for example. And non-stationary effects are illustrated here in the middle column, where the effects are clearly non-stationary in the middle of the time axis. And then how to best account for categorical covariates. So we use an approach that we call category kernel. So if you think about modeling the effect of a pair of categorical covariate Z and continuous covariate X, we do that by using a product of two kernels. The continuous covariates go into the exponentiated quadratic kernel, standard kernel, and then we multiply that by the so-called zero-sum kernel that takes as an input the categorical covariates Z, and then the covariance between these categorical covariates equals one if they are equal, and then they have a negative covariance if they are not equal. We have a small theorem which says that if let's say the jth component of our additive model is modeled by this kind of a category kernel, then both the prior and posterior, or the sum across all the categories of these functions for any time point t is exactly the Dirac delta function at zero. So if you look at the second column in this same plot, then that shows one realization from such a kernel where we hypothetically model the effect of the gender for the females and males. And now if you take any time point here, then the sum of these functions is equal to zero. And then maybe the last column is also worth pointing out. So this shows the category kernel applied to individual subjects. So these are now the individual specific random effects. And again, if you take a sum of these functions at any time point, then they equal zero. And this really gives interpretability for the shared effects, because the category specific effects always sum to zero. So then anything that is shared is then shown in these shared effect components. And this is just to give you a covariance view of these different additive kernels, if you prefer to look them that way. So this first block shows the shared effects. Each block here is one individual. And in this case, there are hypothetically 8 individuals in this study. And then the three other covariance matrices show the category covariance functions. Maybe the one worth pointing out here is the individual specific random effect, where you have the diagonal blocks corresponding to the individuals and then the weak negative correlations between the individuals stemming from the zero sum kernel. And here are some realizations from these kernels. Then disease effects are typically assumed to be kind of correspond to relatively rapid changes that happened around the time of the disease onset. And those are maybe best modeled using non-stationary kernels. Instead, we propose to use so-called variance masking kernel, which forces the disease component to have a zero variance prior to disease onset. So the covariance matrix is shown here, and then realizations from the model are shown here. The hypothetical disease onset is here in the middle of the time axis, and then the variance prior to disease onset sort of approaches to zero. And this can be obtained by this simple product between the non-stationary kernel and then the variance masking kernels. Biology, especially in biomedical applications, the effects may be also heterogeneous, especially for complex diseases, meaning that maybe not all of the case individuals who get the disease have exactly the same effect. Or maybe the effect has the same shape, but possibly different magnitude. And that we can, for example, model using a kind of a heterogeneous kernel where we introduce an additional magnitude parameter beta I for each of the case individuals, and then obtain the final heterogeneous kernel by multiplying the variance masking non-stationary kernel with the heterogeneous magnitudes. And illustration of that is again shown here on the right. So this is the covariance matrix, and then these are the realizations from such a model. And now each individual has a slightly different magnitude for the effect. We try to define robust priors for all the unknowns in the model, including the kernel parameters, all the parameters of the observation model and other parameters. And then we sample also, for the non-Gaussian likelihood models, we also sample the posterior of each and every component of the additive model. And then the sampling we do by using the dynamic Hamiltonian Monte Carlo sampler in the stand. we sampled the full model where all the covariates are included, or all the additive components are included. In biomedical applications, we are often interested in quantifying the relevance of one covariate to the output. We tried to use different projection predictive techniques previously, but then we ended up using a technique which I'll try to explain briefly. It's a little bit technical, but let's hope that I'm able to explain it. So for each sample from the MCMC technique, our model gives predictions for all the data items, for which we can also compute a mean. We first compute a noise proportion, which is simply the residual sum of squares between the predictions and the data items, and then the explained sum of squares, which is between the predictions and then the mean. This equals zero if the predictions fit the data, and this equals one if the model gives constant predictions. And the final relevance of each component in the additive model is obtained by dividing the actual signal or the variance associated with the signal between all the model components, J of them, where these are again the sum of square differences from the jth component mean. And then we compute an average over the MCMC samples to get the final relevance. So these have some useful properties. So all the relevances are between 0 and 1. And if we take a subset of components, then the relevance is simply sum of the relevances of the components. If we take two component subsets, J and K, then it holds that the smaller subset has a smaller relevance than the larger subset. And then the component relevances and the noise proportion then sum up to 1. All right, so let's see how this works. So this is a hypothetical simulated data scenario with a different number of data points. And we simply test that how much better we are able to account for nonlinear effects essentially by comparing against the linear mixed model LMA. And clearly based on the ROC curves, when we measure the relevance of the covariates, we do get much better precision in choosing the relevant covariates for the model than what we get with the linear mixed model. And then when we increase the amount of data, then the accuracy gets better. Our model is also better than the previous Gaussian process models. I'll skip the details maybe and jump to the next figure to demonstrate that how we can detect heterogeneous effects. So this is a hypothetical simulated data scenario again, containing 16 individuals, 8 of them have a disease, 8 are healthy controls. And then we hypothetically assume that, or simulate the data in a way that only 2 of the diseased individuals has the disease effect, or 4 or 6 or 8. And demonstrate that in all these cases, we are better able to detect the heterogeneous disease effect across the individuals. Even more so, that we can also identify the individuals which have the disease effect and those which do not. And very briefly, here's an illustration of one real data set. It's a longitudinal proteomics data from a type 1 diabetes case control study. One of the measured proteins is shown here, color-coded with the cases and controls. And then we can apply both the homogeneous additive GP model or heterogeneous additive model, so that we sort of essentially deconvolve the data into different components that we assume to be present in the data. And clearly there's a relatively strong age dependency in the data. And we can also identify a disease effect, which appears to be maybe even stronger if we allow heterogeneous disease effect modeling. And there are 11 cases, diseased individuals in this study, and then these show the kernel density estimates of the disease effect for each individual. For about five of the individuals, we do get relatively strong evidence that there is disease effect present in this particular individual, and whereas there is probably not in the others. Okay, we can also model temporally uncertain effects. So if there is uncertainty in the explanatory variables, we can set the prior either for a global effect time or a difference between the true effect and then the clinically observed disease initiation time. So you can imagine a person visiting a clinic once a year, or let's say once in 16 months, and then obviously the onset of the disease can be only measured at those time points. Although in reality, the disease can may have happened, or the disease initiation may have happened at any time within that 1 year period when the person has not visited the clinic. And here is an illustration how, again, simulated data, where the red vertical line denotes the true disease initiation time, the blue one is the clinically observed initiation time, and then now we can also obtain a posterior estimate of the disease initiation times for all the case individuals. Juho has implemented this method and maintains a GitHub repository. So in case you are interested, go please check the web page and see and test the method. So that was the first part of the presentation, and now I will switch to a method which we call longitudinal variational autoencoder. Siddharth and Gleb have been the main authors of this work, and then Kalle and Mika have also contributed to this particular study. So very briefly about the notation. So data is now d-dimensional. In real space for simplicity. Covariates for each measurements now have a dimension q, and then we also have a latent random variables denoted as z. And the data can also be split into blocks that correspond to different individuals. So we assume that we have p many individuals in this setup. And this is essentially what I just told you verbally. So the generative model for the LVAE is a latent variable model where the probability of the observed data y given the explanatory covariates x can be obtained by integrating out the latent variable set. The part that we call the decoding likelihood factorizes across the observations. But the prior does not factorize. And I'll try to explain these terms separately. So for the likelihood, we assume a model which is parameterized by a neural network C, such that the probability of the nth observation given the nth latent variable is simply a Gaussian distribution where the mean is obtained by the neural network parameterized by this C, and then we have a diagonal covariance matrix for the observations. This is a very common approach in deep generative modeling framework. The prior is something which we assume to follow multi-output additive GP model parameterized by that. And I'll spend another slide to explain the prior, because that's sort of the crucial part of this paper. So we assume that the model is a vector-valued additive model for the latent variable z. So in this case, we assume that there are r many additive components in the model, plus some residual noise diagonal with the diagonal covariance. We assume specifically that each component has a multi-output GP prior with a component-specific cross-covariance function So this is now a L by L matrix valued cross covariance function. And thereby the sum itself now has additive GP prior with zero mean, and then the cross covariance function is just the sum of these component specific cross covariance functions. We assume that the diagonal cross covariance function is diagonal, so that the L by L matrix valued function has this particular diagonal structure, which then means that the prior in terms of a Gaussian process terminology, that the prior of the latent now factorizes across the dimensions. So there is one Gaussian distribution for each of the latent dimensions L. And even though this may look like a simplification, this is completely non-restrictive in a sense that if you remember the generative model, the prior is followed by a decoding likelihood. So the outputs of the Gaussian process, multi-output Gaussian process prior, are multiplied by the first layer of the decoding likelihood neural network. Sort of in a sense similar as is what is typically done with these linear models of co-regionalization for multi-output GPs. So it's not really a simplification after all. So then the question is that how we can infer this model. It's easy to postulate the model, but then the inference may be challenging. Instead of a full Bayesian, let's say Markov-Chase Monte Carlo sampling, we use a variational inference, in particular so-called auto-encoding variational Bayes for this model, which means that instead of estimating a data point specific variational parameters, we use amortized variational inference, where the parameters of the variational approximation are obtained as an output of a neural network function, where the variational approximation factorizes across the data points, and then for the nth data point, the mean and variance or covariance is obtained by neural networks mu and sigma, which are then parameterized by the neural network's weights phi. Again, a common technique in the autoencoding framework. And then we use the standard evidence lower bound objective. So we optimize the model parameters with respect to bound that in general has this known form where we have the reconstruction part, which in this case turns out to be easy to compute because both the variation approximation and the decoding likelihood factorizes across the data points. And then we have the Kullback-Leibler divergence between the variation approximation and then the prior. And this is something which may be a little bit more difficult to compute. And now this we would like to maximize with respect to the encoder parameters, decoder parameters, and then its multi-output GP prior kernel parameters. Well, first of all, because both the likelihood and the prior factorizes across the dimensions, because we use the diagonal cross-covariance function, then the Kullback-Leibler divergence also factorizes across the dimensions. So that simplifies the Kullback-Leibler computation a bit. And again, note that the variation approximation and the prior, they are both normal distributions. So we have a closed form solution for this Kullback-Leibler divergence. The difficulty is that the computational complexity is still cubical, because now we sort of need to have the full data in our variation approximation and the prior, all the n data points. So before going into any other details, we can sort of view this model in terms of autoencoding framework, where on the left we have the data. Each data is now a sequence of items in total n data points. The data is then decoded using encoded using the encoder network to get the parameters of the latent representation. For the latent, we have the multi-output CP model, which depends on the explanatory variables X, and then we can decode the data back using a decoder, and then also make predictions for the future time points. And then one or two slides about the technical details, which makes this more efficient. So in order to overcome the cubical time complexity. So we derive a novel divergence upper bound, which builds on the fact that the Kullback-Leibler divergence can be written in this form, where and then we can obtain an upper bound by simply approximating this log marginal likelihood of the Gaussian process by any lower bound. So any lower bound of the GP Gaussian process marginal log likelihood provides us an upper bound for the KL divergence. So I don't have time to go into details, but I just give you a kind of a flavor of what we did. So we first derive, we improve the well-known free-form bound of the Titias for low rank inducing point approximations of GPs, and we derive a new evidence lower bound that is tighter for longitudinal Gaussian processes. The bound happens to have this kind of form, and those of you who know the work of Titias, then the kind of the key difference is maybe observed here. So instead of looking at the diagonal elements of the covariance matrix only, now we have terms which correspond to P many individuals in this longitudinal study design. But the derivation of this is in the supplementary of the paper. So now we can plug in this a new lower bound into this equation to get an upper bound. And going through the math, then the derivation gives, sort of the computation gives us this kind of upper bound for the Kullback-Leibler divergence. And now the computational complexity of this is something where we don't have a cubical term, but only linear relationship to number of data points. And then we can even formally prove that for any set of inducing points for the underlying multi-output CP, this novel divergence bound is tighter than the one that we would get with the free-form variational bound of the Titias. And again, the proof of that is in the paper. But still, this may be somehow limited to applications where the amount of data is very high, because it depends linearly on the number of data points n. So then we follow the approach proposed by Hensman, 2013. And derive an upper bound that is compatible with mini-batch based stochastic gradient optimization. And this is the bound, and I will not go into details, but maybe just point out the first term. So now the bound can be written as a sum over the individuals. So now we can mini-batch over the individuals. Again, assuming that there are relatively many subjects in the study, and the length of the time series for each subject is sort of smallish. So then that provides a direct way of doing a mini-batch-based stochastic inference. Okay, here is a brief comparison of our method against other similar techniques in the deep generative modeling framework. So we sort of compare our method with other methods in terms of being able to model shared temporal effects or individual specific temporal effects, how well we are able to account for different types of covariates, can we do mini-batch based inference, model temporal irregularities and whether the model is general. Our model has a tick in all of these boxes. And very quickly, a couple of demonstrations how this technique works. So we take this kind of a toy example of rotated MNIST experiment. We take 400 of these MNIST digits for training and 40 for testing. We rotate them with evenly separated rotation angles, 16 of them, and 5 of those are left out from the training data. In this case, there are only 2 covariates. There's a categorical ID, which tells the identity of the digit, and then the continuous angle. And then we use the same neural network architectures as in the previous works. So here is a training sequence, and then this is the reconstruction. And now the goal is to be able to predict the missing images using the generative model together with the covariates that we are given. And if we compare this technique with other similar techniques, particularly other variational autoencoder techniques, which assume a Gaussian process prior for the latent variable, then we do see that our method gets a much slower MSC error. And that holds for across all different latent dimensions that we tested. Another example is a so-called health MNIST experiment. It's a simulated data set. Again, it's a toy data in a sense that we try to kind of capture the same type of features which are typically present in biomedical data sets, but using images as a way to illustrate the methods. So we take 1,000 unique instances, so let's say 1,000 patients, and then for each instance we get 20 data points, so we have 20,000 data points in total. In this case there are 6 covariates: hypothetical age, ID, disease present 0, 1, disease age, gender, and location, and depending on the value of these covariates, the images are either rotated or shifted towards the left corner of the figure. And then this then tries to demonstrate that after training, we give the model first few time points and then try to predict the remaining time points using the covariates of the remaining time points. And then compare the prediction accuracy against several other methods that have been proposed in the literature. And this is the smallest MSC error that we are able to obtain. The last demonstration shows the application of the method to the so-called Fusionet 2012 data. So where the goal is to predict in hospital mortality of intensive care unit patients. There are about 4,000 individuals for training, meaning about 200,000 data points altogether. This many individuals for testing. And in this case, the data contains about 35 different observed features, glucose level, blood pressure, body temperature, and so on. And 9 explanatory covariates, ID, time, ICU type, height, and so on. And then after training the model with this many individuals, then we would like to use the model in a predictive way and predict the in-hospital mortality for the individuals in the test data. And obviously for the test data, we do not know the value of the mortality covariate. So we kind of use, we do a classification using the generative model as a primary component. And we simply apply a kind of a Bayes classifier type of approach where we compute the probability of the mortality via the lower bound of the marginal probability of the data by conditioning the model with a value of mortality being 1 or mortality being 0. And this is coming directly from the evidence lower bound computation. And now comparing our method against many other methods in the literature, we do see that the prediction accuracy seems to be, well, quite a lot better than in for the other methods. All right, so a short summary is that I think that these novel longitudinal modeling tools are quite flexible. They are formulated as Gaussian process models. They are quite interpretable because they are additive models. They're also quite accurate based on the results that I just showed you, and there are more in the papers. And they are also quite efficient in terms of computational complexity. And these are the people that I would like to acknowledge for different parts of the work. So thank you. That was all. I think I took a little bit more time than I was expecting to take, but we still have some time for questions.
Yes, so thank you for the great presentation. So indeed, we do have a few minutes for questions. So who would like to start? Okay, so there's, okay, Sami has raised the hand. Please go ahead.
Hi, Harri, thanks for the great talk. So would you like to comment a bit on the missing data issue? How easy is it to handle missing data in this framework? In principle, of course, possible, but in particular, structured missing, so that there would be some blocks missing from some of the variables at some times.
So I think that the method can handle data which is missing completely at random. And now there are two different types of missing data. So whether the observed kind of the dependent variables Y are missing or whether the explanatory variables X are missing. It's trivial to handle the missing values in the Y, in the observed data, assuming it's missing completely at random. But we can also take into account the missingness in the explanatory variables simply by masking out the corresponding kernels from the additive GP model. It's not a perfect solution, but it's something that works in practice reasonably well.
Yeah. How is the computational complexity of this, or would you just leave them out from the equations?
Yes, they are essentially just leave out from the equations.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you. Do we have still more questions? Okay, so there is one in the chat. Do you want to ask it, Antti, yourself, or would you like me to read it?
I can read it myself. Okay. So the question is, have you evaluated how well the models capture uncertainty? So especially kind of the latest LVAE predictions you showed seemed extremely confident, and there sort of seems to be a concern that maybe they are overconfident and you were only showing MSE evaluation, which wouldn't capture this.
Yes, that's a good question. I think in some other experiments we have also computed the locked predictive densities, but I don't have a kind of a complete or good answer to your question, but there is a risk of overfitting. We use this kind of training validation optimization scheme where I think relatively well detect overfitting by always evaluating the trained model during each and every epoch on the validation data set. But that's a possible problem, but I don't know. That's the best answer that I can give you at the moment.
Thanks.
Okay, great, thank you. So if there are no more questions, I think our time is ending soon. But again, thank you very much, Harri, for the interesting presentation and everyone for joining, and see you all again next week at the Machine Learning Coffee Seminar. Thank you.
Thank you.